Thank you. Thank you. So I pull a Rick Warren and say, have I told you lately that I love you? Because I sure do. I love you. And you'll just make me cry. Don't do that. Don't do that. I'll cry soon enough. It is a thrill to be with you tonight. It's absolutely amazing. Just totally incredible. So I want to start tonight by asking you this very profound question. I really want you to pay attention to this. This is like uber profound. Does God ever dance on your potato chips? I want to read this to you. Recently I had, this is not me, but okay, just set that up that way. Recently I had one of those days. I was feeling pressure from a writing deadline. I had company arriving in a couple of days and the toilet was clogged. I went to the bank and the trainee teller processing my deposit had to start over 3 times. I swung by the supermarket to pick up a few things and the lines were serpentine. By the time I got home, I was frazzled and sweaty and in a hurry to get something on the table for dinner. Deciding on Campbell's cream of mushroom soup. I prefer tomato, but anyway. I grabbed a can opener, cranked open the can, and then remembered that I'd forgotten to buy milk at the store. Nix the soup idea. Setting the can aside, I went to plan B, which was leftover baked beans. I grabbed a Tupperware from the fridge, popped the seal, took a look, and groaned. My husband isn't a picky eater, but even he won't eat baked beans that look like caterpillars. Really frustrated now, I decided on a menu that promised to be as foolproof as it is nutrition-free. Hot dogs and potato chips. Retrieving a brand new bag of chips from the cupboard, I grabbed the cellophane and gave it a hearty pull. The bag didn't open. I tried again. Nothing happened. I took a breath, doubled my muscle, and gave the bag a hearty wrestle. With a loud pop, the cellophane suddenly gave way, ripping from top to bottom. Chips flew sky high. I was left holding the bag, and it was empty. It was the final straw. I let out a blood-curdling scream. I can't take it anymore! My husband heard my unorthodox cry for help, and within minutes, he was standing at the doorway to the kitchen, where he surveyed the damage. An opened can of soup, melting groceries, moldy baked beans, and one quivering wife standing ankle deep in potato chips. My husband did the most helpful thing he could think of at the moment. He took a flying leap, landing flat-footed in the pile of chips. And then he began to stomp and dance and twirl, grinding those chips into my linoleum in the process. I stared, I fumed, and pretty soon I was working to stifle a smile. Eventually, I had to laugh, and finally, I decided to join him. I, too, took a leap into the chips, and then I danced. Now, I'll be the first to admit that my husband's response wasn't the one I was looking for, but the truth is, it is exactly what I needed. I didn't need a cleanup crew as much as I needed an attitude adjustment. And the laughter from that rather funky moment provided just that. So now I have a question for you, and it's simply this. Has God ever stomped on your potato chips? I know that in my life, there have been plenty of times when I've gotten myself into frustrating situations and I've cried out for help, all the while hoping God would show up with a celestial broom and clean up the mess I've made of things. What often happens instead is that God dances on my chips, answering my prayer in a completely different manner than I expected, but in the manner that is best for me after all. Sometimes I can see right away that God's response was the best one after all. Sometimes I have to wait weeks or months before I begin to understand how and why God answered a particular prayer the way he did. There are even some situations years later I'm still trying to understand. I figure God will fill me in sooner or later, either this side of heaven or beyond. Do I trust him? Even when he's answering my prayers in a way that is completely different from my expectations? Even when he's dancing and stomping instead of sweeping and mopping? Can I embrace what he's offering? Can I let his joy adjust my attitude? And am I going to stand on the sidelines and sulk, or am I willing to learn the steps of the dance he's dancing with my needs in mind? I'll be honest with you, sometimes I sulk. Sometimes I dance. I'm working on doing more of the latter than the former. I guess the older I get, the more I realize that he really does know what he's doing. He loves me, and I can trust him, even when the chips are down. Some of you may feel like that tonight. You may feel exactly that way, and I am so glad that you are here. We've come together to encourage each other, to speak of hope, and to restore our faith. Tonight we're going to be talking about flight, a life in motion. And through these years of Saddleback, some of you may have heard me say that I have a fantasy about flying. I mean like being able to fly. I don't mean in a plane. I mean like me personally, I can fly. Just before I go any further, anybody else share this? Any of the rest of you be willing to, in your dreams, do you fly? Because see, there's either flyers in their dreams or non-flyers. Most of you. This is so great. I've always thought I was so weird. But there's just something about it in my dreams where I can fly. It's amazing. I mean, it's like, you know, when Superman and he takes Lois Lane's hand and they're just like soaring through the sky together. I think it's amazing. Or Aladdin and Jasmine, you know, and whole new world kind of thing. I love it. So I finally found something that epitomizes what it is to me to be able to fly. I want you to watch this. Some of the best dreams I ever have when I wake up. I really hate to fly in airplanes. I am a white knuckle flyer. I've been known to hold the hands of strange men on airplanes. If you ever hear that rumor, it's probably true because I got scared and grabbed somebody's hand. But the personal sense of flying is just the most amazing thing, to be able to soar and leap and do these perfect landings. And some of you might probably say, yeah, I want to fly. I would like to fly away. My life is a little complex right now. I'd like to get away from the clamor and the stress and the noise and all that's going on. Because even good things can create that desire to get away. Psalm 55:6, it's on the screen there. It says, "Oh, how I wish I had wings like a dove. Then I would fly away and rest. I would fly far away to the quiet of the wilderness." How many of you could like just sing that song? All right, that is, you would love to just be able to escape a little bit. Well, we're not alone in that feeling of overwhelm. That is so common to us as human beings. And in the book of Isaiah, which is our theme verse for tonight, Isaiah 40, 31, in the book of Isaiah, if you have it, if you brought your Bible, you can turn to chapter 40, because I'm going to read the entire chapter to us before we dig into just that last verse. But you need to know that the nation of Israel, was in a period of rebellion. And for 39 chapters, the prophet Isaiah had warned the nation of Israel of what God was going to do. He was telling them that there was going to be captivity ahead for them. Things were going to get very bad because of their disobedience, because of their rebellion. And yet in chapter 40, the book shifts a little bit, and now it's again a prophecy, but it's actually a prophecy of comfort. And God says, yes, after you have suffered, after you have been in captivity because of your rebellion, because of your disobedience, I will comfort you. And that's where we are. It also is a messianic psalm, as you'll read, messianic chapter, as you'll see as we read through it, because it talks about a kingdom that is not yet of this world. It's a prophecy of their captivity and their comfort, but it's also a prophecy of what God was going to do ultimately with the nation of Israel. And so it was a word to those people in that day. When they heard it, they knew that God was telling them what was ahead for them. It's a prophecy for people who were yet to come, and it is a personal word for us tonight. So I want you to read it. Read along with me as I read chapter 40. In Isaiah. Starts off and says, comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem. Tell her that her sad days are gone and her sins are pardoned. Yes, the Lord has punished her twice over for all her sins. Listen, it's the voice of someone shouting, clear the way through the wilderness for the Lord. Make a straight highway through the wasteland for our God. Fill in the valleys and level the mountains and hills. Straighten the curves and smooth out the rough places. Then the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all the people will see it together. The Lord has spoken. A voice said, shout, and I asked, what should I shout? Shout that people are like the grass. Their beauty fades as quickly as the flowers in a field. The grass withers, and the flowers fade beneath the breath of the Lord. And so it is with people. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our God stands forever. O Zion, messenger of good news, shout from the mountaintops. Shout it louder, O Jerusalem. Shout and do not be afraid. Tell the towns of Judah, your God is coming. Yes, the sovereign Lord is coming in power. He will rule with a powerful arm. See, he brings his reward with him as he comes. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will carry the lambs in his arms, holding them close to his heart. He will gently lead the mother sheep with their young. And then it shifts a little bit. Who else has held the ocean in his hand? Who has measured off the heavens with his fingers? Who else knows the weight of the earth or has weighed the mountains and hills on a scale? Who is able to advise the Spirit of the Lord? Who knows him enough? Who knows enough to give him advice or teach him? Has the Lord ever needed anyone's advice? I've often thought he needed mine. Does he need instruction about what is good? Did someone teach him what is right or show him the path of justice? No, for all the nations of the world are but a drop in the bucket. They are nothing more than dust on the scales. He picks up the whole earth as though it were a grain of sand. All the wood in Lebanon's forest and all Lebanon's animals would not be enough to make a burnt offering worthy of our God. The nations of the world are worth nothing to him. In his eyes, they count for less than nothing, mere emptiness and froth. To whom can you compare God? What image can you find to resemble him? Can he be compared to an idol formed in a mold, overlaid with gold and decorated with silver chains? Or if people are too poor for that, they might at least choose wood that won't decay and a skilled craftsman to carve an image that won't fall down. Haven't you heard? Don't you understand? Are you deaf to the words of God, the words he gave before the world began? Are you so ignorant? God sits above the circle of the earth. The people below seem like grasshoppers to him. He spreads out the heavens like a curtain and makes his tent from them. He judges the great people of the world and brings them all to nothing. They hardly get started, barely taking root, when he blows on them and they wither, and the wind carries them off like chaff. To whom will you compare me? Who is my equal? Asks the Holy One. Look up into the heavens. Who created all the stars? He brings them out like an army, one after another, calling each by its name. Because of his great power and incomparable strength, not a single one is missing. Oh, Jacob, how can you say the Lord does not see your troubles? Oh, Israel, how can you say God ignores your rights? Have you never heard? Have you never understood? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of all the earth. He never grows weak or weary. No one can measure the depths of his understanding. He gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. Even youths will become weak and tired, and young men will fall in exhaustion. But those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. God, your word is the most powerful word that we can listen to. Anything I have to say is nothing compared to the majesty of your word, how you reveal yourself to be the God above all, above any idol that we could make with our hands. You are the God whose hands formed the circle of the earth. You formed the mountains, the seas, the land, the animals, the people. God, your works are amazing. And you, this huge, transcendent, bigger than our whole imagination can contain, God, loves us as individuals, as people, as women. And sometimes, God, we are weak and weary. Sometimes our strength fails. Sometimes we can barely put one foot in front of the other. And yet you have such tenderness toward us. You're not content to leave us there in that heap, in that pile. God, tonight as we spend some time thinking about what this word means to us personally, thank you that it meant something to the people thousands of years ago, that you were a faithful God who could keep a promise even when that promise was a painful one. That you're the God who could keep the promise to bring a savior and bring a redeemer and a kingdom that would never, ever end. You're that God. And you are the God who, in this moment, for the women in this room and those watching and those who will watch it in the days to come, each is dearly known and loved by you. And so you have a personal word of hope and encouragement and healing tonight. As best we know how, God, we open our hearts to you. Go past the defenses, whatever they are, whatever the barriers are that we have erected to keep your word out and away and at arm's length. I pray that your spirit would ever so gently break down those barriers, break down those walls, so that we could hear and receive and be revived by your word. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Well, in this chapter that we read that describes who God is and what he's like and what he's up to, it ends with that magnificent promise. There's a promise that we're going to be looking at in chapter 40, verse 31. And I want you to notice just right off the bat who the promise is given to. The promise is given to the weary and the tired. The promise that God culminates this chapter with is given to a special group of people, the weary and the tired and the weak. See, this promise of soaring like eagles, of being like an eagle, is not given as a prize to the strongest, to the most successful among us, to those who have their acts together. It's actually given instead to those who may be at the end of their rope. It's given to those who are deeply discouraged, those who are frustrated or wounded by life's circumstances, those with illnesses that won't go away, with grief that is so deep. We often think that God shows up on behalf of, it's kind of like the American way, the rich get richer. You know that phrase, the rich just get richer. Well, we tend to think of that's true in God's way of dealing with us, that the strong get stronger. And therefore, if you aren't strong, there's not much hope of ever becoming strong. It's like somehow there's this magical equation that we haven't figured out, but that is just not the way God works. It's not what he promises here. And to me, that's a piece of good news. That is an excellent piece of good news. It already encourages my soul. Because as I read that silly little story at the beginning of the woman who feels like God's dancing on her potato chips, and you could maybe relate in some ways to the fact that your life may be surrounded and you may be knee deep in potato chips at the moment. I just want to tell you that's where I am. I'm not coming to you in this moment strong, per se. I'm not coming to you even as the person that you've known for a long time. I'm not myself. And I don't actually know when I will be again. And to pretend otherwise would be to lie to you and to make you think that somehow I've got some magical, special ability that you don't have to deal with hard stuff. It isn't true. It isn't true. One of my greatest joys in my 34 years at Saddleback has always been to be in the middle of the congregation. I have loved to sit right there in that space. And then when they did the remodel, I moved over to this space because I was too far. But here, so that Rick could see me, so he could catch my eye, so that I could sometimes try to give him the evil eye to try to get him to not say certain things. It has never worked once in 34 years, but I keep trying to see if that eye will get him, and it doesn't. But I have loved being in the middle of the congregation. I have loved being in your midst as we sing and we worship and we share and we cry and we love God together and when we share our lives. And I have to tell you that right now that's more than I can do. I haven't sat on the front row in 15 months and I don't know when I will. I will, but I don't know when it will be because it's overwhelming to me. It's too difficult. It's not something that I can do. In my life, those potato chips are scattered, metaphorically, all over the floor. But the good news is I'm exactly the person that this promise was designed for. And you are exactly the person that this promise was designed for. Because even if you're feeling pretty good right now, there have been moments in your life when you would say, I am weary, and I am weak, and I'm tired. And you can remember those days. Well, what is it that God is holding out to us who are weak and tired and weary? What is it that this promise is about? Well, he promises strength and vitality. Those are such appealing words to me right now. He promises strength and he promises vitality. Often when we're tired, we're looking for rest. We're looking for rest, like that psalm where he says, I want to fly away like the dove and be out in the desert and in the wilderness and be at rest. Often we're looking for that. But what God promises in this particular verse is something very different. He says, I promise you vitality and strength. If you've ever been at a point in your life different than you are right now, where you had days or years or times of great strength and great vitality, and there may have been a shift either in your health or in your circumstances, and to think about and long for those days of strength and vitality, that is a very encouraging promise to me. Most of you probably don't know, but our daughter Amy has had a chronic illness since she was about 15 years old. So for the last almost 20 years, she has lived with a debilitating fatigue that was finally diagnosed a couple of years ago as chronic Lyme disease. And I have watched my precious girl barely able to lift her head off of the pillow for weeks and months at a time. When getting up to brush her teeth was a good day. That was a significant activity on some days. And the longing that she feels to feel good again is so palpable. You can almost touch it. You can taste it. Some of you can identify with chronic illness. And in the past year, I've experienced a fatigue that has really surprised me. The gals I work with would confirm this. My family would confirm this to you. There are some days I can hardly form words for conversation with my mouth because it takes so much effort. And I long and I ache for that strength and that vitality that had characterized my life in other times. Well, God says, I'm going to give you strength and vitality like the eagle. Why did he pick the eagle? Why didn't he pick those cute little hummingbirds? Why didn't he pick sparrows or robins? Why did he pick eagles? Those things are fierce. If you get up close, I mean, if you look at pictures, those are fierce birds. And that's the point. They are fierce. They are unusually strong birds. They can fly longer and higher than almost any bird that God has made. They are some of the most majestic and powerful birds on the planet. I learned something about eagles this week just to fill your mind with useless trivia. But I bet you don't know this, but you can amaze your children or your grandchildren with this factoid. Eagles' nests are about 6 to 8 feet deep, about 20 feet long, and they weigh literally a ton. They are massive, an eagle's nest, because the bird itself is so big, it's so massive. Their eyesight's phenomenal, they can fly higher and further, they have a long lifespan, they're extraordinary creatures. And when God wants to use a metaphor to tell us, to give us something we can hold on to, something concrete we can say, okay, I get that. When he says, I want to give you strength and vitality like the eagle, that gives me a picture of something that I want. As cute as hummingbirds are, man, those little things, you could just flick them with your finger and they're gonna go down. They are beautiful little creatures, and I love them. Animal activists do not hate me. I'm not saying do that. I'm just saying they're so tiny, and they're so fragile. You would no more flick an eagle than you would flick Godzilla. I mean, it's just not going to happen. They're big, they're majestic, and they have unusual strength and vitality. Let me show you from an eagle's point of view. I showed you my dream of flying. Let me show you an actual eagle, little camera strapped to its back, didn't hurt it, no animals hurt in the filming of this video, to show you what it's like in 1 minute to be an eagle. Watch this. Is that amazing? Do you see how high? Did you see, and did you realize there was no flapping? That was an eagle soaring. I want that. Do you want that? I want that for my life. I don't really want to soar like that eagle. I want my life in my spirit to soar like that eagle. There's some myths about eagles, like they intentionally seek out storms to, you know, there's this, it makes for great stories, but it's not really true. Really what they do is they use the wind. That bird was using the wind. That bird had found a way to surf the wind, if you will. It rode the wind, and because it did, it didn't have to flap its wings. It could just efficiently move from spot to spot, and you saw that it shifted. And I don't think it was shifting based on, oh, I like that tree better than this tree. I think it was following where the wind was going. It followed the wind, and it hung out on that wind, and it was able then to soar, saving it energy and efficiency, because it has learned how to use something that can be very destructive. Would you all agree that the wind can be very destructive? The wind can be very destructive. Some of you have personal experience with wind and destruction. But here is an eagle, rather than being slammed to the ground by the wind, has found a way to ride it, to surf it. That's what it means to soar, and that's what we're looking for. There's a condition, though, There's a promise. God says, I'm going to give you strength and vitality to those of you that are weak and tired and weary. But he says there's a condition, and the condition is it is for those who trust in the Lord, for those whose trust is in the Lord, for those whose hope is in the Lord, the NIV version says. Well, what does it mean to hope in the Lord? That sometimes we use sentences or phrases that people just go, great, that sounds so amazing. What in the world does it mean? Let me come back to that in a second, but let me tell you how you can know for certain when you're not trusting in the Lord, when your hope is not in the Lord. There's five of them. Worry's the first one. Probably the number one impediment in our walk with God, the number one place that most of us get stuck in our relationship to God. Worry fuels anxiety, and anxiety morphs into depression. And you know, ladies, I could give you truly a laundry list of my regular sins, and some of you would like that, but I'll just let you in on this one, and it's worry. It's one of the ones I have struggled with the most. I come from a long line of worriers. People who struggled with anxiety, both out of a seemingly genetic predisposition to it and out of habit. I saw it modeled, I adapted it for myself, and I went to town with it. I know how to worry about anything and everything and nothing at all. I can just worry for worry's sake. Anybody else? Thank you. I always hate to be the last one, the only one who's got a sin in her life. So it's been quite a growing process in my 60 years to learn how to relax into God's care for me. But when I worry, when you worry, that is not having hope and trust in the Lord, and you will not soar. Second thing is when we take matters into our own hands, when you take matters into your own hands and you try to fix it. See, worriers tend to try to fix the things they're worried about. The two kind of go together. And I think most of humanity's problems come out of this tendency, this addiction to running our own lives. And hoping in the Lord, that little phrase, hoping in the Lord, sounds incredibly simple and almost stupid when you think of it as a strategy for trying to solve problems. Doesn't it? Doesn't that sound like really a stupid thing? Well, just hope in the Lord. It does. It sounds really, really stupid. And there is a bit of a dance, because God does expect us to use the brains that he's put inside our heads to figure some things out. But what most of us do, and I'll just say myself if nothing else, because if you're not really willing to go to this one, you may admit to worry, but very few people are willing to admit that they are control freaks. So I'll just say it for you. But most of us rarely give God a chance to fix it, because we're so busy trying to fix it ourselves. You need this, you need money, you need a new job, you need a husband, you need this, you need food. I mean, whatever it is, we decide that we can fix it, that we can use the brains that God has given to us, and rather than even offering him the opportunity to fix it for us, we're very busy in trying to fix it ourselves. Third thing I think that we do that shows we're not hoping in the Lord is when we become bitter. I read to you verse 27. I'll read it to you from a couple different translations. One of them says, how can you say the Lord doesn't see your troubles and isn't being fair? Another translation says, why would you ever complain, O Jacob? Or whine, O Israel, saying, God has lost track of me. He doesn't care what happens to me. Another translation says, Israel, why then do you complain about that the Lord doesn't know your troubles or care if you suffer injustice? Evidently, there were quite a few people that Isaiah was writing to who had decided that God had abandoned them, or that he loved somebody else more than he loved them, and their hearts had become bitter. You know, bitterness, I mean, worry, yeah, that's a pretty benign thing to admit. Control freak, yeah, you know, a few of us will admit to that. But here's the one that very few people will admit to: bitterness. And bitterness is such an ugly emotion. Nobody wants to be thought of being bitter. Nobody wants to say to themselves or to anybody else, I am a bitter person. Nobody wants to say that. And bitterness is like acid. It's corrosive. It will eat through love. It will destroy relationships. It will corrode gratitude. Eventually, bitterness will become apparent. It will become something that you can't hide. It'll leak out. It'll spill out into conversations. It'll spill out when you're jostled in a relationship issue. Bitterness won't stay hidden for long. And when our hearts are bitter toward God and to other people, it causes us to give up hope. It even causes some people to not seek God for help anymore, but to actually turn away from Him. And that's the fourth way that you can know that you're not, when your hope and your trust is not in God, and you're not gonna find the strength that you want, you're not gonna find the vitality that you're hungry for, you're not gonna soar like an eagle when you actively rebel. See, in our despair or frustrations with God or our circumstances that rocks us, sometimes we deliberately choose to go against God. Sometimes we intentionally, eyes wide open, say, God, you have let me down. You haven't been there for me. You love other people more than you love me. You do what they want. Why are they better off financially? Why do they have kids I don't? Why is she married I'm not? Why does she have that husband I have the husband I have? Why did I get that job? Don't tell me you haven't said it because you have. Why does she? But your husband has said it about you too, so it works both ways. And your kids have certainly said, why did I have these parents? So we've all said it. But when we let that bitterness take root in our hearts and we get angry at God and we get angry at other people who have what we want and don't have, or we have something that we wish we didn't have, a condition, a health issue, infertility, a mental illness, whatever it is that we wish we didn't have, we can just end up saying, forget you, God. I've tried it your way, I'm done. And we're definitely not hoping in God when we're in active rebellion. And I suppose the list is really endless of ways that we can rebel against God. I mean, there's not even any point, but I would just tell you this, that humanity as a whole is living in rebellion against God. The Bible says that. It sounds harsh and melodramatic. Look at the daily news. Just pick up one little bit of news, and you will see that our world is in active rebellion against God. And there are so many broken lives because of active rebellion. I have to say this, a little bit of a side note. How many of you read the devotional book, Jesus Calling? Okay. Don't we love Sarah Young? Don't we thank God for Sarah Young and the ways that God has used her to increase our ability to connect with God? Well, on February 26th, go home and read it. I read it every day, even when it's not February 26th, because every time I read it, it smacks me in the face. It smacks me right between the eyes, because she says this, when you try to figure out the future, you are grasping at things that are mine. This, like all forms of worry, is an act of rebellion, doubting my promises to care for you. I wonder how many times you have understood that worry is actually active rebellion. Worry says to God, you can't do it. You can't keep up your end of the bargain. You aren't big enough, strong enough, powerful enough, knowledgeable enough. You, God, can't take care of it. And then we worry and we are rebelling against God. Well, the fifth way that I think that we can not put our trust in God, show that we're not hoping in God, is by becoming apathetic. Some people don't choose the path of bitterness or outright rebellion in the face of lost hope. They just go quiet. They feel let down by God and by others, and they choose to stop wanting, to stop seeking, to stop asking, to stop believing that anything can ever be any different. And their hope isn't in the Lord anymore because He, frankly, seems unpredictable and unreliable or just too slow. Or they conclude that He's impossible to figure out, so they just decide to simply live quiet lives, no big prayer requests, no gigantic, audacious expectations from God, no thrill at seeing Him at work, just quiet. and apathetic and hopeless. Some of you thought when I was talking about rebellion and worry, you're going, that is not me. That's not me. I am not a rebel. But maybe this is where you struggle. You've decided that God isn't enough, and your response, rather than walking away, is you're walking. You're walking by him. You haven't lost your faith. You're not doing anything that anybody else would say was wrong or bad. Nobody could call you on the carpet for terrible sin. You've just lost hope. You've just gone quiet. You're not going to soar. You can't. How do you hope in the Lord? How do you find hope in the Lord? Well, there's two words as I think about it. You can fill them in at the same time. Wait expectantly is the second word. So wait, and the second word is expectantly. Uh-oh, you knew that word would find its way in here somehow, didn't you? That terrible, awful word, wait. I hate to wait. You hate to wait. We hate to wait. It's probably our biggest pet peeve with God. Why, God, are you taking so long? When are you going to get this taken care of? When are you going to fix this? Why are you so slow? How many times do I have to ask? I mean, if I memorize 5 chapters of the Bible and stop watching Keeping Up with the Kardashians, will you answer me then? I know what you watch. I have just spent an incredible week with my 5 adorable grandchildren, and I have so many fresh examples of learning to wait and how difficult it is. The morning we were getting ready to leave to come home, one of the kids, who will remain nameless, was especially hungry and not particularly interested in waiting for mom to come up with a delicious breakfast. Mom was having a bit of a problem because we had decided to empty the refrigerator before we left so that we wouldn't waste a lot of food and there wouldn't be a lot of leftovers. Unfortunately, that made her have to scramble to come up with a breakfast that was satisfying, and my grandchild grew increasingly impatient, began to make faces, then scowls, then pouts, then growling. And I had to leave the room to hide my laughter because it was not going to make the situation any better. It was not going to go over well with the hungry child or the harried mother if I laughed at that moment. But it was such a perfect microcosm of us and what happens when we have to wait. See, this little one hadn't quite learned yet how to hide it behind the socially acceptable practices that the rest of us do. I mean, if you were out at the food truck tonight, or if you're out waiting for your s'more after this, and you start growling about having to wait, I can promise you that your friends in your small group will walk away. They are not going to stand next to you. But here's the deal. Waiting is a major theme of the Bible. In case you hadn't noticed, Abraham waited for the promised son. Israel waited 400 years for the deliverer who would deliver them from that bondage and that slavery. The Israelites waited as they wandered for 40 years for the promised land. David waited for that promised kingship that God said that was going to be his. And the time that he waited, he was running for his life, living in caves, not knowing from day to day whether the person who was after him, the king at the moment, would cut his head off, kill him, get rid of him. The Jews waited for the promised Messiah. The church is waiting for Jesus' return and his eternal reign. And you and I are waiting for all that has been promised to us, waiting for that day when everything that's broken will be made right. There is no getting around it. No one is ever going to figure out a way to avoid waiting, because waiting, hear this, defines our existence. Waiting defines our existence. To be alive is to wait. To be alive is to wait. We wait to be born. I mean, we're 9 months in our mother's wombs. That's a long time to wait to be born. And then we wait to be fed and diapered. We wait to be changed. We wait to be clothed. We wait to be old enough to go to school. We wait to play an instrument, a sport. You have to be this certain age. We wait to be old enough to go to school. We wait for our college, for our driver's license, and for our car, and for our job. And we wait to get that degree that we've been working for as we've been studying. And we wait for love. And we wait for the person that we want to spend our lives with. And we wait for children who appear or don't appear. And we wait for ministry opportunities. And we wait for mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters and husbands and friends to come home from war or prison or from wherever it is they're wandering. We wait for doctor's appointments, and we wait for treatments to take effect. And we wait for our ship to come in, and we wait for better times ahead and for better health and for better days. And we eventually wait for death, for that transition from this life to the next. There's so much waiting. And you'd think we'd finally get good at it. But most of us don't. And we end up wasting our waiting. We waste our waiting, and in so doing, can lose hope. Well, if the way to find hope in God is to wait, because every one of those circumstances, from the Israelites to Abraham, to the Jews waiting for the Messiah, for the church waiting for Jesus to come back, for you and I, every one of those waitings is about hope. But we wait expectantly. We wait with eager anticipation of what has been promised, no matter how long it takes. I read an explanation that makes sense to me. It's like if you were waiting out here for a bus that you knew came by at the same time every day, and you would wait for that bus, even if it didn't come at that particular moment, because you know that's what the bus does. The bus comes. And so you wait. And why would you walk away? Because any second the bus could be coming. And so you wait, and you wait, and you wait. And that's so much the way it is with our lives and our faith. God said that he would send a Messiah, and he did it. And we will wait. We will wait for him to make justice triumph over injustice, for mercy over judgment. We will wait for beauty for ashes. We will wait for the weeping to turn to laughter. We will wait. But I have to tell you that some of the things you and I are waiting for, you might not see in your lifetime. Doesn't mean they won't happen, but you may not get to see them happen in your lifetime. Rick's mother prayed for years for Rick's older brother to come back to the Lord. He had walked away from God, and she prayed as only a mother can for her wayward son. She prayed, she prayed, she prayed. She was faithful, she agonized, she prayed, she believed, she hoped, she dreamed, she prayed. She died before he came back to the Lord. But you know what? He came back to the Lord. He came back to the Lord. Did she get to see it in her lifetime? No, but it happened. For 400 years, the Israelites waited for a deliverer, and thousands died before God sent Moses. Did he deliver them? Yes. Did he do it on their timetable? No. Millions of people did not get to see the promised Messiah when he walked the face of this earth. Millions had come and gone. They never got to see him. Did God send a Savior? Yes, he did. Did they, many of them, get to see him? No. There are millions of people right now who are waiting for Jesus to come back and establish his reign and to end this world in the way that he's promised he's going to. And they even have specific dates, and they've done charts and all this kind of stuff, and many of them have already gone to heaven. Did they see him come back? No. Will he come back? Yes. You don't seem very sure of this. You were pretty confident there at first, but you're like, trick question. I'm not going to say it very loudly. Did God keep his promise? Yes. Did he send a Savior? Yes. Will he come back? Yes. Do we have to be afraid it won't happen? No. Will he keep his promises in your life? Yes. Oh, that was weak. Yes. Will he make it right, all that concerns you? Yes. Will it be in the timetable that you want? Wait. Oh, man. I wish I was a betting person. I could have made money on that bet right there, because I knew you were ready to say no. Here's the right answer. Maybe. Maybe he will. Maybe you will see it. Maybe you won't. But will he do it? Yes. Hope says, I'll keep waiting, knowing that he who promised is faithful. Romans 15:13, I'll close with these verses. Romans 15:13, may the God of hope fill you with joy, fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow by the power of the Holy Spirit. That's one of the verses that has kept me going this year. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The next few verses were written by a man who was waiting expectantly for God to work, and listen for the peace of mind that is displayed as he soared. Psalm 57:1, have mercy on me, O God, have mercy on me, for in you my soul takes refuge. I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings until the disaster has passed. Psalm 91:4-5, he will cover you with his wings. You will be safe in his care. His faithfulness will protect and defend you. You need not fear any dangers at night or sudden attacks during the day. And I love this one, Psalm 63:7, because you are my help, I will sing in the shadow of your wings. Say that one out loud with me. Because you are my help, I will sing in the shadow of your wings. I love poetry, and Emily Dickinson has written one that many of you would know. She's written this little, this is a snippet of one of them. It says, hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. We've talked about potato chips and how sometimes God dances on them, about weakness and weariness, about a thrilling promise that God has promised for those who will put their hope in him, promise of strength and vitality, about eagles and how they paint a picture of what it is that God wants to do in our lives, how he wants to give us a soul strength that will take us to the end, whenever or wherever that end might be. We've talked about how to recognize when we're not putting our hope in God, when we're not putting our faith in him and his promises, and the need to learn to wait expectantly for him to do his work. But there's one more thought that sums it up for me. Several years ago, I found myself dreading the future. I'd been diagnosed with breast cancer and melanoma. I didn't know if they would return. I still don't. No way to predict. I didn't know what was going to happen with our mentally ill son, and what I would do if my worst nightmares came true. What if it all happened so differently than the way that I longed for it to? What if I gave up in the waiting? What if I couldn't wait any longer for God's answers? What if my strength gave out before my days were finished and that worry thing kicked in so badly? I have to tell you, I came to a moment, and it's the moment that I believe God is asking each of us in this room, as you're watching. This is the moment that I believe you are here. You have one question to answer before the Lord tonight. And the question, you have a decision to make. This is the decision that I made. With your help, God, I will not let anything destroy me. With your help, with God's strength, I will not let anything destroy me, because greater is he, 1 John 4:4 says, greater is he that is in me, that God's strength, his very life, inhabits my soul. So he who inhabits me and lives inside of me is greater than he who lives outside, greater than any force, any accident, any tragedy, any circumstance. God's life in me is stronger than anything that can happen to me. I have repeated it many times since that day, several years ago. I've repeated it almost every day for the last 15 months. I've said it twice in the last 10 days to women I love very much as they have faced their own devastating losses. And I say it to you tonight, the strength that God promises to give to all those who are weak or weary or tired, scared and worried. That strength is enough to carry you through the toughest winds. Soaring is not for the strongest among us. Please don't misunderstand me. Soaring is for the weakest. Soaring is for the weakest. But it's really up to you. And here's that question. Here's the decision that I believe God is asking you to make. Can you, will you, be willing to say, God, with your strength, I will not let anything destroy me. I may be shattered, I may be crushed, I may be flat on my face on the floor, but with your help, God, with your strength, I will not let anything destroy me. Deuteronomy 33:25, a promise, may your strength match the length of your days. That's my prayer for you, ladies, that God's strength in you will match the length of your days. I want us to close reading Isaiah 40:31 together. It's there on the screen or on your outline. I'd like for you to stand, actually. And this is a moment that I want you to read this with confidence, because this is the word of God to you personally. But those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. God, we come to you again to say thank you, to say thank you for the promise of strength in our weakness, in our weariness, in our fatigue. Thank you, God, that you've given us a pathway to follow. It's not mysterious. It's not something we have to try to figure out through some esoteric way or some goofy program. God, it's just so simple. It's to take you at your word. You are God. You are God. And you have made promises to your people. And you're a faithful God who keeps promises. And so we take you at your word tonight in our own lives, not for others, not for the woman sitting next to us, not for our children, not for our friend, but God, for us, for me tonight. I tell you again that with your strength, I will not let anything destroy me. Not because I am strong, but God, your life is in me. You inhabit me. I am one with you. And with the strength that you impart, you promise that I will soar like an eagle. And I pray for my sisters, God, for those tonight who realize they've never accepted Jesus Christ. This is all a bit confusing and they don't even know what this is about. God, for any woman who recognizes that she has never yet put her faith and her hope in you as her Savior, as her promised Messiah, in this moment, I ask that she would just turn her life, just simple words. God, I don't understand what it all means, but Jesus Christ, I ask you to be my Savior. You said you would do that, God. You keep your word. And for these, my sisters, who are walking in different ways, some are brand new believers, some have been walking with you for a very long time, where we're worried, God, forgive us. Where we are control freaks, forgive us. Where we are in active rebellion against you, we repent. Where our hearts have gone bitter, because we're disappointed, or we're frustrated, or the waiting has just gotten so long. Forgive us. For those who are apathetic, who've decided that they will just live a quiet life with no expectations from you, may they repent. May we come back to you and seek you, believing that you are the God who you say you are. We trust you. We place our hope in you tonight. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.